Okay, so this says that we're streaming, but let's see if YouTube shows that we're streaming. Okay, and looks like we have a solid connection. Hey everyone, long time since I've done a live stream here in the actual office. I relocated half of my camera equipment to my home office, but I got some new equipment here. So today we have ourselves an interesting one. We have an iPod 5th gen. This is the kind that still has the plastic on the front of it before they switched over to the 6th gen, 7th gen, also known as classics, with the metal on the face. However, the 5th, 6th, and 7th pretty much are identical as far as battery replacements, hard drive replacements, or in this case, battery terminal replacement. So what happened here is someone has already gone ahead and opened up this device. And this is pretty common. Now, what happened in the process of opening up is the battery terminal was still connected to the battery when it was ripped up or when it was removed. So it pulled the whole entire battery terminal up, as well as some traces on the main motherboard or logic board. So what we're going to do today is just go ahead and try to repair these traces and be able to get a whole new replacement header put back in its place. So let's go ahead and switch over to our temporary overhead camera right here. We're not directly overhead because my overhead camera mount is at the home office. So first thing we're going to have to do is pull the main board out to get to the traces. Mostly because the traces are pretty far damaged. It looks like it actually went through some vias. Take a look underneath the scope here. So you can see right there, that's where the battery terminal normally rests. Where we have our damage is going to be right here on a via. I mean, all five of the six traces have been ripped up. It looks like this is going to be a. If I had to assume, this is going to be a ground connection for these two pins and this pin. So these all share one giant copper ground connection. Looks like we're going to have either a data line connection. This is what I'm going to assume is that this is a data line connection right here. And then if I had to guess, this is going to be our voltage. We'll confirm later, but just kind of looking at the anatomy of the board, that's what we see here. We won't be able to just solder the attachment replacement header back in place because what we're going to have to do is kind of make a brace right here that touches these vias that are on the underside of the board. Hey Tim, it's good to see you. So, in order to really get in here through this metal chassis, we're just going to pull the main logic board out. So let's move forward with that. Wrong camera. So let's start off by removing the auxiliary cable right here. And then we have the hard drive. Hard drive is going to be held down with a ZIF connector, ZIF, zero insertion force connector. And now let's remove the LCD. Now the LCD has an interesting flex cable. I've never seen this color on an original LCD. So I'm wondering if this LCD has been replaced, or if the fifth gens actually did have some sort of blue coating on the LCD. And now we have six side screws that hold the outer frame into the middle frame. So we need a Phillips head screwdriver. And if I had to assume, the main reason this happened in the first place was that it's a fifth gen. These, I want to say, were manufactured around 2010. They quit making iPod Classics in 2015. So this one might actually be even older than 2010. So just the battery, the lithium ion battery in it, just finally went bad due to old age. And I'm actually rather impressed. The frame is in pretty good, the outer frame or back frame is in pretty good condition. These normally get really tore up when opening up the iPod. And if you can pardon me for one second, all my other technicians are busy, so I'll be right back. All right, thank you so much for waiting. We're just in the middle of a work day right now, so kind of juggling some phone calls. Let's get back to this side camera. Wrong side camera. Overhead camera, that's why. Tim says, how many techs do you have? As of right now, there is three of us, including myself. We are looking for another technician, another level two technician, and my wife has actually had to step down to kind of take care of some more personal stuff. So she's not working here as much as she used to. Before, she was a technician as well. So we're down a technician. We're also looking for another technician to kind of fill in that gap. So if anyone is in the upstate South Carolina area and your passion is Apple product repair, you already have some experience with computers, MacBooks or iPhones, or at least have a base that you bought from, we are actively looking for a level two technician. All right, so we have now removed the faceplate from the middle frame that has the logic board and the scroll wheel. Now, some iPods, like the 6th and 7th gen, will actually have two screws right here. However, this one does not have it. We look, the logic board looks to be held down with just adhesive. So we should be able to just apply a little bit of pressure and pop this logic board out. Yep, that's all that is just double-sided tape that's holding this board in place. If you have a 6th or 7th gen, you will have two screws, though, right next to the click wheel that you'll need to remove first before you can pull the logic board out. And it looks like the hard drive spacers had fallen, so we'll just need to make sure that when we're done with the repair, put those back in. So we can set the frame, the mid-frame aside, and then also to not get in our way, we're going to remove the scroll wheel itself. Scroll wheel is also held down with another jaw connector. Going to pop that up right there. And then some more adhesive. I'm going to use the back end of my black stick. Break the adhesive off right here. This guy right out. So our logic board is down to its bare bone, and it's prepped and ready for us to put on the new battery terminal. I'm going to clean up my area a little bit more just so that I don't knock anything while I'm underneath the microscope. Set this stuff to the side. And let's look through the microscope camera. Right there. So as mentioned, we have this via. And let's look on the other side of the board to see what that's coming from. It could very well be coming from this diode right here. Nope, because the diode comes to that side. So it looks like the via is going to be in a couple different areas, so we can't see directly to it. We can very, very faintly see that it is hiding right here in between this component and this capacitor. It's a tiny, tiny little dot, so we won't be able to solder almost like a through hole. We're just going to have to connect to this via, so we're going to have to expose that. Looks like YouTube is giving me warning that our bit rate is not high enough, so let me adjust this real quick. Right back. Okay. And we just had to go ahead and adjust your bit rate. So now, what I'm going to do is etch into the fiberglass to try to expose traces. And today I'm experimenting with a noise gate just so that you all don't have to hear phone ringing or other conversations that are going on in the office. So if I sound like I'm cutting in and out, it would be just that one filter is turned on in OBS. Okay, so I can see a little bit of a trace right here, but what worries me is I'm curious if that's ground or if that's part of this via right here. So what we're going to do is we're going to get our multimeter. And I don't have my Bluetooth multimeter with my one eye connected, so what we're going to do is just get this other generic multimeter, the peak meter, and we're going to put it in continuity mode, so whenever we hear a beep, we know that we are touching the same line. But just to make sure this is working, okay. Want to do is poke. I'm assuming this is ground, so let's make sure nothing here is grounded. Okay, now let's poke these two vias together. They're connected. And what about right here? Yep, so that tiny little exposed bit of copper is going to be part of the same line. So let's expose just a little bit more. That way we can get a nice piece of wire. Normally don't do iPod repair. It's a specialty service that we offer because not that many people apparently offer it anymore, but one of my favorite things to do to the iPod Classics is to upgrade the battery, or the hard drive, I'm sorry, upgrade the hard drive to a solid state drive so that you can actually add more storage. So I think the max these took were 160 gigs, maybe it was 180 gigs. And you can put in a 240 or a 480, but you run into a limitation where you can only have, I think, 50,000 songs on some models. The iFlash, which is an adapter that allows you to put an mSATA or M.2 SATA solid state, has all the guides or all the compatibility charts on what drives you can plug into iPods. Now I'm going to grab a fiberglass tool and try to expose a little bit more of this trace just to make sure that this isn't ground. Because sometimes you'll have ground in the inner layers of boards and you have traces that go in between. So this is just a pin. It has some fiberglass hanging on the end of it. And that looks pretty clear for the most part. Let's make sure, once again, that we're just not touching ground. So I'm going to put one probe on ground and poke over here. We look pretty solid. But yeah, if I had to guess, this is going to be some sort of power. I think from here, we can go ahead and just make a foil out of jumper wire. I'm going to then mask it up afterwards. Okay, so for that, we're going to need some jumper wire. And for that, we also need our fume extractor. Our turn on our... Oh, you can already hear it. Turn on our micro pencil. And a little bit of flux. Now we're going to tin up this area. And let's just kind of dab that with some new solder. And this is the part where it starts to get a little blurry because my camera's not really the greatest. So it tries to overcompensate for the reflection that's coming off of the flux from the light. So I think the white balance or the exposure trying to overcorrect itself and things start to look a little muddy. If anyone has a good recommendation for a new microscope camera or one that can handle a high quality stream, I am open for any suggestions. So, let's just dab this wire right here. Great. So that solder is in place, or not solder, but the wire is in place. And now what we're going to do is we're just going to cut a bit of the wire and we're going to wound it up. We're shaking a little bit too much right now. Ah, you know what? I actually have a handy tool I completely forgot about. Completely forgot about this tool, but it's a board holder. When it comes to tiny little boards like iPhones, this is a really good tool. And where'd my tweezers run off to? Ah, there they are. Good. And I apologize. I'll be right back. Got another phone call. Back into the microscope camera here. Alright, so we have a little bit of wire, and so what we want to do is just kind of make it go around, wound around our tweezers, so that we have a little bit more surface area. And this is a trick that's used a lot in iPhone repair. Essentially, you're making a new pad. And there's another phone call. And let's go back around again. I'm not the best when it comes to making coils, and I will be the first person to admit that. All right, so now that we have a little bit of wound up right there of a coil, what we're going to do is apply a little bit more solder. So what we're going to do is we're going to apply a big ball of solder onto my tweezers. I'm going to hold this down. Touch up the wire. Almost like ink and quill. I'm going to put some solder on the end of our tip and just go over and touch up this pad. And this is going to allow us to make a new pad. Okay, now we can't really see much, so we're going to go ahead and clean this up real fast. And there goes another phone call. All right, so it can be a lot prettier. So let's work on that. Let's go ahead and add a little bit more flux, and then we're going to get a jumper wire going so that we can pin this pin to this pin, this trace. And another phone call. All right. I apologize, guys. Hold on just for 1 second. I'll be right back. That we're running into with the iPhone 6 is the supported operating system will only go so high, but it won't go to the latest anymore. Okay. Potentially. It does look like the highest operating system the 6 goes to is iOS 12, which is an operating system from 3 years ago. So the thing is, Safari gets updated with those updates with versions of iOS. So if you're having issues with Safari, it could very well be because you are behind on updates. Have you tried a different browser, such as like Google Chrome or Firefox? Okay. Okay. Yeah, that would be my recommendation if you're already on iOS 12, is to try a different browser to see if that will get you into those websites. But if you're not on iOS 12 and you need support with that, that is a service we update for no charge. It only takes typically about 30 minutes to an hour, depending on how much data you have. So other than that, if you are on iOS 12, then the best recommendation would be to try a different browser like Google Chrome or Firefox. Are you trying to free up space on your phone? Yes. So if you're trying to free up space on your phone, what we would do is we would upgrade your phone using iTunes with one of our computers here. But one of the first steps before iTunes will actually do the update is it's going to back up your phone to our computer just to make sure that the update goes through smoothly. And depending on how much space you have, like I said, that could take a couple of minutes. I had a client 2 weeks ago. She had 200 gigs worth of data on her phone, and it took about 2.5 hours to do the backup before we could even do the update. So if you were to free up any space that you're no longer using, old applications or old photos and videos, that will make the backup process a lot quicker so that we can do the update process. And that's another thing, is in order for us to do the update, you will need to free up space. It won't let us do the update if you're running out of space on your phone. Okay, perfect. So we work on a walk-in basis, so you're welcome to stop on by whenever's convenient for you. Exactly, yep, that's a good time frame. Awesome. Well, if there's anything else we can help you out with, just give us a call. All right. Thank you, sir. Have a great one. Thanks. Bye. All right. Thank you all for your patience. Let's get back to this. So we were in the process of... Oh, were you able to figure that one out, Sophia? Perfect. Awesome. Okay, back to the microscope camera here. For those that are viewing, thank you so much for your patience. All right, so now that we have our pad here, what we want to do is just kind of run a jumper wire from this pad to this pad. But what we'll need to do is expose. So we're going to have to expose a little bit of this trace. So let's clean this up one more time. So I've used a high-grade isopropyl alcohol. I'm going to evaporate it. And now let's etch into the board. And this is just exposing the top layer of the trace so that we'll be able to solder a wire to it. Now this part of the trace is already lifting a little bit up the board, so I'm going to solder a little further down. All right, so we've pretty much exposed all of the trace. Make sure we'll kind of touch up the last little bit with our fiberglass pin here. Beautiful. Now we're going to solder a wire. Put a dab of flux on top of the 2 points. Spread it out, and now let's grab a wire. And we are using mechanic jumper wire. It's an iPhone chip conductive wire. This is, it does have an enamel coating on it. So this is really good if you need to solder a wire in tight places, but also give it a little bit of protection so that it's not bridging anything. They do make non-enamel coated wire. So that way you can just solder directly onto whatever you need. This stuff is just a little bit thicker of a gauge than my non-coated wire. My hands are still a little on the shaky side today. I think fan in the lobby holding up one of my technicians. They've been up front for probably 30 minutes talking. I can hear that they're trying to get away. Nothing wrong with people who enjoy our work wanting to talk. But it happens the wrong times. Fortunately, we are pretty busy, and we're now down another technician. Only because they're up front assisting this gentleman. Okay, touch this side. So what I'm doing is I'm kind of doubling up on my trace. This is just kind of for redundancy, and just making a complete circle to ensure that is touching. Just in case somehow this pad or this trace, this wire breaks in the process. And now that I think about it, this solder is actually taking a little while to, never mind. Forget everything I was just about to say. Tim, I've noticed you've done a lot more videos lately. I've been trying to watch them. Proud that you've been able to keep up with the schedule. I saw that you did a switch the other day. Good content. Keep up the good work. All right. Hands just need to stop shaking today. That's the downside, is you'll have some days where your hands are perfectly still. Other days where they just are uncontrollably shaky. I find that hitting your hands, having someone either slap your hands or hitting your hand against the table, assuming you don't have arthritis or any hand injuries, will kind of stabilize your hand. On days when my hands are really, really shaky, I'll have my wife slap my hands, and it works. Okay, so, second time, let's clean this up. And now we're going to heat it up with our heat gun just to help evaporate, and now we're going to get our conformal coating. This is the stuff that cures with a UV light. And to keep it consistent, I'm gonna go with a green one, green color that we have here. We're gonna get just a very thin layer to build up with and stretch this over everything. Kind of have to start with some small layers and work your way up when it comes to conformal coating. Alright, so that's a pretty thin layer to start off with, so now I'm going to put on my UV protective goggles. There's just like a red light goggles. You can get these from Amazon for around $15. But this just kind of filters out all UV light and blue light, so everything is all bright and orange, and it looks like the sun is setting right now. And I'm going to grab my UV pin just to protect my eyeballs. That's the main reason we wear these. And we're just going to go over kind of give this a good touch with a UV light. Now, when you're doing this, you don't want to look in the microscope because you're magnifying the light waves from the UV pin into the magnifying glass or the microscope. And there goes another call, and both my technicians are up front helping another customer, so I'm going to mute this real quick. One of them was able to multitask, so they were able to grab it. With all the interruptions, I'll have to end up making another video just chopping this one down, so I appreciate those who are watching this live stream. Okay, that should be a good amount on the first layer. Now, let's add another tiny amount on here. We're gonna have to do this a few times. Okay, that's probably more than enough, so we need to stretch this out. That is our second layer. The second layer should probably be more than enough for this specific trace. Now you can see that we have covered up our new trace. And what we're going to do is once this is all nice and hardened with our UV pin, we're then going to etch into the UV the cured mask, formal coating, expose that trace. This is just going to assure that the new wire on here, the new trace, is not going to move. Especially as we heat it up once we put our new battery terminal in place. Just want to make sure that the solder doesn't try to run off. Doesn't try to break the connection. Now, since this was a little bit thicker of a layer, I'm having to apply a little bit more UV. Or by apply, I mean just kind of hit it with some more light. We'll get a little bit closer to while we're at it. And so I'm actually looking through my my camera monitor. I'm not actually looking through the microscope in order to view what I'm touching. All right, let's take a look at this. Right, that is all nice and hardened. Let's kind of get away the residual layer. And that's a nice, clean-esque surface. Now we're going to grab our scalpel, kind of just expose this. Now our new pad is ready to be soldered. It is ready for the new terminal. And then of course we want to make sure that our wires are being conductive between the two pads. So let's grab our multimeter, continuity mode, and touch both sides. Continuity mode, touch both sides. Perfect. So that is all nice and solid. We successfully have a bridged wire right there. So now, the next steps we're going to have to do, we're going to have to pretty much do the same thing here. We normally have two pads, and then we had another one right here. So there's two ways that we could go about this. We could either make put down some wire and kind of make some pads like we did before on both sides, or we can finish up this trace, leave these blank, put down our new terminal, and then solder wires between the terminals. Those are two different ways that we can go about it. For the sake of this video, this live stream, let's just go ahead and put some traces down. So I'm just cutting in or exposing the top layer of this. And I want to assume that this is a ground connection. We can kind of confirm by putting our multimeter back into continuity mode and just touching this part of the iPod. So let's see, is this ground? It is not. And again, oh. And again, that might not be properly grounded. I don't have a schematic here to confirm. But let's take a look here. So here's a capacitor, and this capacitor should be ground down here. So let's check and see. Ah, so I was actually wrong. So this is our ground. So this must be our power. Okay. Just one tiny little detail, that's all. So this is actually our ground connection, while this is going to be our power that is coming, the voltage side, while this is going to be the data line. This is what's actually going to communicate with the iPod to tell it what the battery percentage is. All right. Now we know that a little bit more. Okay, clean up some of that, and then we'll get our fiberglass pin. Touch up this area. Okay, so this is going to be interesting. We're going to have to make a funny little shape here, like an L. That would explain why earlier when I was using my micro pencil, it was taking a little bit longer for us to apply solder onto these pads because it was grounded. Now, something that kind of concerns me, you see right there, there looks like there's a hole of some sort. There looks like there may have been a via here at some point. So there's a via, but it looks like it's hiding underneath here. It doesn't look like that it was actually touching anything. Well, the way that I see it is if we do this repair, and this doesn't work. Yeah, that's deep in there. So that via is not going to be of any importance to us. But I was going to say, if this still doesn't work, then that sounds like that this is going to be... Yeah, it's the same trace. What am I talking about? It's going to work. If not, then we'll kind of pull this off and etch to expose that via. The thing is, you can really only see these vias whenever they're wet. So like if I apply a little bit of alcohol or if I use flux, see right there, that tiny, tiny little hole hiding, but it doesn't look like we can easily get to it. It's underneath the fiberglass, so I don't think that's anything to be too concerned of. So let's keep moving forward with the original idea, making a funny little L. Now we need our jumper wire again. Gotta find the other end of the jumper wire. Okay, and I found it. It all just kind of bunches up together, so it's hard to keep track. And let's touch this up. Okay, so what we're needing to do is basically make a trace. I'm going to make a coil first. Do fairly big coil. And once again, I will be the first person to admit to you, I am not good at making coils. So, this is to be functional rather than aesthetically pleasing. Please, any help or ridicule or criticism that you feel is wrong here, I am open for any suggestions. Okay, now this is not going to be a pretty coil. Let's just go ahead and cut our wire right here. Trust me, just trust me, we're gonna make this work. No! Oh no! It's running away! It's a disaster! Don't worry, we'll make it work. Okay, this is not going to look pretty. It's actually very embarrassing because I haven't been working on iPhones lately, so I'm not as much as a phone technician as I am a MacBook technician, so when it comes to making coils, I haven't had a lot of experience as of recent, so this all just looks like a really, really big hot mess. We're going to try our best to make it look pretty. Problem is, it's trying to run away. Okay, touch this up a little bit more, try to make this a little flatter. And now we're just being a perfectionist, even though this is not perfect in the slightest. Okay, you know what? I think this will be good enough. Now let's clean it up so you can make fun of my work. Hey guys, Esteban and Tim. Ah, ripped off battery connector. Hey, it's good to see you, Pedro. Yes, this is a ripped battery connector. I'm horrible when it comes to making jumper wire or making traces or something this small, like on a phone. So please laugh away, criticize. I'm trying to get this one working for this client. So it looks sloppy, but those two pads that are supposed to go here, the two pins, they actually share the same line. So this is really just to kind of give it some structural integrity more than anything. Now we're going to try to make one more tiny little coil over here and jump it to this hot mess that we got going on. Get your name right this time. I'm sorry, Pedro. I did not mean to sound like I was calling you out the other day. Because you mentioned Colin before in other videos, and I thought that you were referring to DOSDude1. Since that's his name. But no, I've never actually said, really don't say my name on stream anymore. It's not that I have anything to hide, it's that truthfully I just forget about it. But the business, my business is Name I Revive. My name is Esteban. Greetings from Chile. Thank you. Don't let the name fool you, even though my name is Esteban. I am as white as it gets. I can't speak any Spanish at all. I am of Costa Rican descent, but I have been living in South Carolina my entire life, and South Carolina education system taught me just enough to get me by in Spanish. I rip on South Carolina a lot. I'm sure it could be worse. Just from my personal experience, being in high school when I was, things could have been a lot better. We have a lot of people moving. So our education system is slightly getting better just because we have different types of teachers from different states. Slightly. Slightly better. Okay, let's try this hot mess again. So now what we're going to try is a very similar situation down here. Yes. I'm just thinking before we make this move. I probably should have applied some conformal coating onto this before we moved on to the next wire. But I'm going to very, very carefully make another wire. As a Puerto Rican that doesn't speak any Spanish, and also a whitey, I feel the same. Completely understand. I'm glad that you can relate. The thing is, like, I understand Spanish, just because I grew up in a Spanish, kind of a Spanish-speaking household, because my mother is from Costa Rica, my brother spoke Spanish, but... Yeah, at the age of 2, I told my mother, I don't want to learn that language. And for some reason, she just was like, okay, this 2-year-old knows what they want with her life and quit teaching me Spanish. I can't even remember the age of 2, so I don't remember ever telling her that. The rest of my family can speak it, but I can't. But I understand it. So I'll actually have instances. There was one time in particular, it was funny. I had a Spanish-speaking couple come in here. And they saw I had a name tag, and it said Esteban. And in Spanish, they looked at each other, and they said, how do you think this white kid got this name? And I was just like, oh, well, because my mother's from San Jose. And they looked at me surprised that I understood them. Of course, I can't speak back. So the problem that I have with Spanish is that there's like 25 different tenses. So it's hard to remember if I need to be, say, like, hablo. Is it hablo? Is it hablan? Is it hablaba? Hablaba? Hablaban? I have a really hard time trying to figure out the tense. And I just don't speak it enough. That's really what it is practice. You could be an Australian. Yeah? Why is that? You have a lot of Spanish-speaking people in Australia? Or white people with Spanish names in Australia? This coil is looking horrible. You know what? It will work. Like a phoenix, it has risen from the ashes. Born anew. Fortunately, it was born as an ugly duckling. Pedro says, no, Corbin, not Colin. Oh, okay, you're right. You did say Corbin. I'm sorry. Even in the Rossman Discord, I have my name on there, and some people think that I speak Spanish, and then, you know, I understand. I understand why they think that. I'm just a disgrace. Disgrace to my culture. Okay, let's work with this. No, the moment has passed, all good. Okay, now let's go back to grabbing some fresh solder. Make this monstrosity look a little bit professional. Okay, let's work with this. Let's work with this monstrosity. Okay, so we have a little bit of what looks like a peanut right here, and we have a whole bunch of extra solder. Welcome back, Allie. All right, so now we have a little bit of extra wire, so we're going to move that aside. And let's see if we can just kind of touch this up. Have fun, I'll catch up the rest later, and thanks for the stream. Now, thanks for getting on. I can only imagine what time it is right now in Australia. I don't know what the time difference is between here and Eastern Daylight American time. United States time. Oh no, my coil is falling apart. Yeah, it looks like it fell apart. But no, thank you as always for getting on. I appreciate it. Sorry that I'm not as quick as I should be. Okay, so we got that little peanut, a little nugget of solder on our wire here. Oh, 5:26 in the morning. You should go to sleep. I appreciate you watching. However, I hope that you're either waking up really early, enjoying a cup of coffee while watching this stream, and you're not staying up late watching this stream. Okay, so this definitely is a hot mess. Take a little bit of acetone to try to clear up the area, and then we're going to apply a little bit of conformal coating. Retiring in 4 weeks, so. Really? Retiring as in you're no longer doing any repairs? Or retiring as in you're retiring to sleep in about 4 weeks? Because I'm a little bit more concerned. Okay, so let's see if we can make this look pretty. Let's put some makeup on this, a little bit of foundation. Okay, so we got a big glob here, and what we're going to do is spread it out over these two spots. Actually got probably too much on here. And this looks like wire, but this is actually hair. So we're just gonna move that out of the way. Yeah, don't let me keep you up anymore. Go ahead and get some rest. Okay, so we probably have too much of this stuff. Now I'm going to grab a Q-tip to kind of pat this. Okay, same thing as before. We're going to put on some safety goggles. Retiring as a motor mechanic. Soon to be a full-time apprentice MacBook tech. That's awesome! That is cool. I mean, the motor mechanic is pretty cool in itself. I mean, that proves that you have the brain to be able to do this type of work, probably even more qualified. That's something that I wish I could understand. All right. Grant's all joining the MacBook repair world. Yeah, no, in all honesty, that's awesome. Because I've seen you have been posting a lot in the Facebook Mac repair Facebook. I'm sorry. I was thinking and looking and reading at the same time. I wish I could be on the MacBook Facebook a little bit more. Really hard to juggle that while also taking care of work at the same time. And when I get home, I mean, to be perfectly honest, the last thing I want to do is get on the Discord or Facebook and look at more Macs. Kind of like how a chef, whenever they cook all day, when they come home, the last thing they want to do is cook. They just probably heat up some ramen all the day. But no, that's awesome. I'm really happy to hear that. If it's something that you like, if it's a dream, if it's something you thoroughly enjoy doing, if you can pursue that to be a career, that's awesome. It's self-opinionated. We all are to a certain degree. It just means you're passionate. That's all. Okay, let's see if we've touched up this first layer enough to where this isn't going to move on us. Okay, that looks pretty good. So now what I want to do, now that this is kind of being held down in place, we have a good mound of solder on this jumper wire. So what I want to try to do is see if I can push this down a bit. I blame Lewis. Blame Lewis for being self-opinionated? No, if you're just self-opinionated as a technician, that just means that you have a passion, you truly care about the quality of your work. That's a problem that we actually run here on a daily basis. Myself and other technicians here, we probably care more than we should, and we end up spending more time than we should, but in the end, we can sleep comfortable at night knowing that something left here, that they're not coming back. one of the techs says that it's their current situation going on right now. All right, heat that up a little bit. Okay, so now what we're going to do is apply a little bit of flux. And now that it's no longer moving around, I'm going to kind of dab it with our iron. So iRevive, you say that you can buy these connectors on eBay. Yes, I bought these a long time ago. The majority of these connectors, though, they do ship from China. So if you want to keep some, I recommend ordering in advance. I think I bought 5 for 20 a while ago, actually. Oh no. This all just kind of came apart. Oh no, okay. Speaking of self-opinionated, this is horrible. Okay, let's see if we can bring this back. But yeah, you can buy these, just the majority of these come from China, so it's something that they're just inexpensive enough to keep in stock. So I recommend just buying maybe 3 or 4, 5. Oh no. Great. There's an easier way of doing it. I know it is. Oh no. You see that? The wire broke. Okay. We don't make mistakes, we make happy accidents. Sorry, A1932 battery died. Yes, I was surprised that they sold them. Yeah, almost any parts that you buy for iPods, whether it's the fifth gen or the classics, they're going to be coming from China. For instance, the auxiliary ports with the lock button at the top, I can't find any of those locally. I have to always order those from China. So I'll keep one in stock. We'll do the repair when a customer comes in. Then I'll order another one from like AliExpress. And it'll take a good while for it to show up. Okay. So it's a tiny, tiny little trace now, a tiny little pad. See if we can make it just a hair bit bigger. I think that's as big as I'm going to be able to make that one go for now. Okay, let's just keep moving with it. Yeah, that could be a lot better. So what we're going to do for now, we're going to keep putting a little bit more conformal coating on here just to cover this layer. I think what we're going to have to do is work with this so when we lay down our terminal, we'll be able to kind of give it a little bit more solder. Fully aware this is not pretty. Go, it's a little bit bigger. Okay, we can work some more with that. And so now let's put down another tiny layer of conformal coating. And we probably still have a little bit too much, so let's just dab that real quick with Q-tip. Let's kind of thin that out. Okay. And let's see how that's holding up. So that's really not moving anymore. I think now let's actually do, sorry, just a little bit more. I know every time I think I'm certain, I just want to be a little bit more cautious. See if we can add just a tiny, tiny little bit more of this stuff. Right up here at the top. My intentions were to not have the stream go for an hour. I appreciate everyone's patience while we get this solved. I think we are good here, so now what we need to do is expose a little bit more of this trace. Yeah, this video is definitely going to get chopped down into like a 10-minute video. Beautiful. Oh, let's also expose a little bit more of the bottom down here. And now what we're going to do is touch our multimeter into continuity mode so that we hear some beeps. And see if these work. Yep, they're good. All right, very last one. Very, very, very last one. What I'm doing is I'm exposing a little bit of the trace right here. All right, and now that that's exposed, we're going to kind of do this one more time. We're going to put a little bit of solder and make a coil that looks a little bit prettier than what we got going on here. And now let's get some more solder wire. You know what? We're going to mix it up a bit. I think one of the reasons I'm having issues here is because of the conformal coating. I'm going to switch to a type of jumper wire that does not have conformal coating. And the only downside is this jumper wire is a little bit thinner. The stuff is 0.009 millimeters thick. Not sure what that would translate to gauge. I don't think they use gauge when they get this small. Sounds like we're having a U8900 come in. Here's someone talking about a GMUX issue. Alright, so this stuff's a little bit thinner. Now the trick is to try to get this as thin as possible. Cool, looks like we got it. Now let's cut some length of this wire off so that we can wound it up into a tiny little coil. Stuff's bending a little bit easier too because it is thinner, so this might have been the right way to have gone in the first place. U8900 repair, gotta love them. Mm-hmm. We do get a good bit of those, and it sounds like one's about to come through. I'm sure I'm doing the coil method one of the most complicated ways possible too. Seeing where people solder a wire onto a like a BGA chip, and they just spin it around, make a coil. I've also seen, I think a company, I want to say Qianli, actually sells pre-coiled traces, and that would be perfect for this type of work. This wire to sit a little bit more flat. Pedro, I thought you were getting out of here. Let's see. Okay, now we gotta try to get this to lay flat. And the problem I have is this is too big of a gap. They are freaks. I don't know what I see more. U8900 repairs or Emux issues with 2011s. We still get a good bit of the 2011s through here. I was past tense. I appreciate you sticking around. Okay, so now let's try add some solder. That went on a lot easier. See, that's exactly how all of them were supposed to be. So the problem that we looked like we had here was the other wire, since it had enamel coating on it, a little harder to make, to bridge solder between the wound up wire. Okay, so now let's add. Evaporate this with some hot air, and we still have a little bit of residual flux left behind, so we're going to touch that up with some acetone. Acetone tends to be really good at this. Done a few 2915 demuxes too. Yes, we've had a surplus of those. Actually, no, I take that back. Not in the last couple of months, but we've done a good bit of the demux on those. Get a lot of 2850s as well, the 2010s with the bad tantalum capacitor. That's actually probably my most common mail-in repair, I would say. Do you ever watch your own videos? I don't really have enough time, to be perfectly honest. Time is something that I don't really get often. I have a lot of personal dilemma that's actually happening outside of the business right now, so when I'm not here, I'm taking care of that stuff right now. What I'll probably do, I'll watch the beginning to see if I have too long of an intro, to see if I need to cut something out, and then I'll also see the end to see if it actually finished with the stream, but hardly ever have time to sit down and watch my own videos anymore. I mean, I was there when they were being recorded, so I know what happened. I just don't have time to edit them anymore. I used to edit my own videos and then post them up, but streaming seems to be the most efficient. That way they get automatically uploaded in real time. I don't have to worry about trying to render the video so that I can upload it to YouTube afterwards. Maybe when I have more technicians here and I have a little bit more downtime, I'd be able to do some better videos, but right now this is what I got going on. I appreciate everyone's patience, and one thing I really like about the repair community on YouTube is people don't care about the fancy bells and whistles or the, hey, make sure to like, subscribe, and smash that button, leave a review and comment behind. Now, everyone's just here to get some knowledge, some board repair ASMR. So the barrier to entry as far as like quality goes is very, very light, nice, very low. I'm content with that. All right, let's go ahead and put our safety goggles back on. Sorry to hear that you're having some life. What makes life interesting. But I appreciate you being concerned. Everyone has their own issues, right? Tim knows that I talk a lot. There's nothing wrong with that. In fact, actually, that probably that helps everyone. That helps you. That helps Tim. The more comments and chats during live streams helps. I think that helps the YouTube algorithm. Okay. See, is this good? That's all nice and hard. Let's make sure that that tiny little wire, because it is a smaller wire, let's make sure that it has continuity between the pad and the trace. It does, so let's apply just one more small layer of coating. And this one, I think, is ready for us to actually put the terminal on. Okay, so now let's apply a little bit more UV. I want to do a keyboard replacement video about not having to drill. Do you normally use a drill whenever you do a keyboard replacements? My experience with keyboard replacements has been A1502s, A1398s, A1466 and 1465, and even the 16-inch A2141. But all the USB-C models, anything that has a butterfly keyboard, I have not been successful on doing. But normally I use Nipix pliers for pulling out the parts. Don't really ever have to use a drill. Pedro knows what I'm talking about. I'll have to go back and watch that one. Okay, so I think we're good as far as our coding goes, so let's just expose. I need to take these safety goggles off. I can barely see anything. Okay, so let's just expose some of our solder. Are you guys good? Do you need any help? Okay. The person that came in, is that the one you're working on? Okay. There's a Facebook about drilling or not. Now, I'm not saying that drilling's a bad idea. I've seen people drill. I actually have seen Alexi, or Inwerp from the Rossman Discord, he uses a hand drill. It looks like a Phillips head screwdriver, but he has a drill bit on the end of it. Now if you look, you can see I just made a mistake. Let's see if we can put that back. I really want to save you. I think what we're going to have to do for redundancy, we're going to have to end up soldering a wire from here to here in the end. To make sure that this is actually going to hold itself down. Now, just to make sure that that wire is still intact, do continuity mode, touch both pins. Still surprisingly there. All right, so we are officially at the point of putting on a battery terminal. VomRed.red. I'm not sure what that means. Okay, now let's grab ourselves here a replacement battery terminal. Pedro started it. The discussion? I'll have to look at that one. Okay. So when it comes to anything like this, I like soldering to ground first, just that way we have a nice solid connection. Stability. So let's see, so this... Oh, hold on. This is backwards. One second. Flip this around. Ah, so there wasn't two traces down there. It was just one, because we only have one pin right here. To drill or not to drill? That is the question. Yes. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to cheat. So this is a little brown part on the iPod, and it should just come right off. Let's see if it's going to come straight out. Oh! I was trying to do that on the camera, but I don't think I can. Try. Oh. Wrong camera. It was supposed to be facing downwards. What's going on here? Everything's broken. There we go. Okay, let's see if we can pop off this connection. Okay, so what we did is we separated this into two pieces. We have the white part and the brown part. The brown part's really just what kind of applies pressure and latches everything in place. So let's just move forward. Yeah, and I was saying that I found the proper screw so you don't have to drill. Oh, okay. Are they just like slightly bigger? I'll have to check that one out. Doxing the staff. And see, we might have to edit that part of the video out. I personally think that Allie would not mind. Allie actually is a Twitch streamer. Alright. She plays League. League of Legends. I'm getting seasick. I'm sorry. Okay, so now let's go ahead and apply some solder to our ground connection. Hey, do the same thing to the other side, and it looks like that wire that we made down here is gonna live. Easy on the crotch cam there, fella. I need drama, mean. I'm so sorry. That wasn't supposed to happen. Okay. That nice and focused as best as we can. We're going to touch up this side. And hands are shaking a little bit too much, but we should get this on here. Aha! That will work. It's not pretty, but it will work. All is good. Thank you. Okay, so let's see if we can just kind of touch up this pin. And it looks like we will still have to apply some flux and solder there. What about you? That one went on no problem. Okay, and then this pad as well. This is... it's going to be a power line, and it just ate up all of our solder. Okay, so let's touch up this ground connection. Just add a little bit more solder. It looks as decent as that's gonna get. Ground is kind of a heat sink, so it's dissipating heat just as quickly as I'm applying it. Now let's try this. What I'm assuming is a data line path. That looks like that's on there pretty good. And then the part that is a little suspicious is going to be this power line. This definitely is a little point of concern. We look good there, but I think what I'm gonna end up doing anyways is running a jumper wire just for the hell of it from here to here to make sure all that's fine. But before we do that, let's make sure what we got going on is pretty solid. So let's put our multimeter back into continuity mode. Okay, so we hear a beep. We know that everything works when we touch, so let's touch these two pads. All right, so these two pads down here are working. And then these two should be the same. Well, oh, of course these are the same, because if you look, this line, or these two connectors, are actually going to be this ground connector. So really, we want to see if these two are touching, and they are. What about this one? These two are touching, so that's for the power. And then this is going to be the data line, I'm assuming is a data line. And I want to see where this goes up to, because I've actually covered everything in conformal coding, and it looks like it goes to this via all the way over here. So let's see if we can kind of just barely expose. Cool. All right. So that all looks pretty solid down there. Like I said, just to be safe, we're going to run a jumper wire from this top right pin all the way to the bottom. And this time we're going to use again the non-conformal or the non-enamel coated wire. That seemed to play in our favor. Truthfully, I probably should have done that in the first place, but I don't do this specific repair enough to have known from experience what to work on. Or exactly what tools to use. What we're going to try to do, wrap this around. Okay, so let's touch this up. All right, that seems good. Now let's bring that all the way around here. Bring it around town and touch it up right here. Okay, cool. So now we have a wire that is actually wrapping around the terminal, as well as going from one pad to the other pad, so I think we're pretty solid here. I linked the video to this repair on iFixit forum thingo. I hope that the finished video link is the same as the stream link. I will confirm that later. I'm personally not going to be taking down the stream, so as long as the video is the exact same, from my experience, YouTube keeps it the same, then it'll stay up. It will stay up. Truthfully, it will be a while before I can actually get a completed, edited, like 10-minute video on this. So, you know, taking the time to do that, I appreciate that. That truly means a lot to me. I never would have even thought about that, nor would I have the time. Time is definitely a virtue right now. Okay. Now what we're going to do to provide structural integrity is we are going to put some more conformal coating on top of our pins here. Just to really make sure everything's going to stay down. Cool. No, thank you. I truly appreciate that. I heard a quote the other day that really, really struck home with me. And it said, someone asked, what is it like owning a business? And the response was, have you ever tried winding down at home with a Red Bull? Trying to relax by drinking a Red Bull. Kind of how things have felt lately. But I have a fantastic wife who's been helping me, and my staff is amazing. I could not have asked for better teammates, better technicians. All right. Sounds like we got some homework on that one. Cool. I am a global citizen. So just putting a thin layer over our pads here to give some more structural integrity. Everything underneath is ugly, but we're just putting some makeup on. The whole point of makeup, right? Making things pretty. Okay, let's put a little bit more around the top left. I love how I came back in the stream at the right time. Awesome! Yep, we're near the end. The important thing is making sure that this works. Hello from Romania. Thank you for joining. Okay, so I think that is a nice thin layer for us to start with. But like before, we want to do our safety goggles first, just to make sure that we don't hurt our eyes, because our eyes are very, very important when it comes to board repair. Parting it up, as we say. Hello from Sweden. This is awesome. We're getting people from all over the place. Oh, thank you all for joining. Fill you in real quick. We have been replacing the traces on this damaged iPod 5th Gen motherboard. And we finished putting some functional traces in place. And now we're actually soldering on the terminal. The terminal's been soldered on, we're just applying some conformal coating onto everything. What's up? Yeah. I'm finishing this one up right now. If you can give me an hour on that, I can do that one. Thank you. So the conformal light coating I put on was just a little on the thicker side, so I'm just having to use a little bit more UV. All right, let's check and see. Everything looks pretty solid right here. It's a little wet still on this side. So now let's put some more. We're going to do another layer. Kind of touching this back up like we did before. Nothing too exciting. And the gentleman with the iPhone 6 with iOS 12 from earlier is here. That's cool. He got here pretty quickly. All right, so once again, that's still kind of a thicker amount, so let's see if we can spread that out. We'll just move a little bit over onto the right side of this pin. Same thing here, we're going to move a little bit on the left side. A little thick here, so let's stretch that out, thin it out. Okay, that should be the last little bit of conformal coating mask that we're putting on here. So we are near the end. Now we just got to find out if that one via that we had, we saw underneath the board when we put some isopropyl alcohol, if that is a via of concern. Personally, it didn't look like it actually went to the top layer of the board, so I think we're still fine. Because the trace itself was going from the bottom right pin to the top right pin. I think that if that via was important, we wouldn't have had the traces bridged like that. So we need to get all parts of the mask, the conformal coating with UV. It wasn't really curing right here on the left side because I didn't really hit it. I promise this was only supposed to be a 30-minute stream, not 2 hours. Is it for a MacBook Air? I actually have some MacBook Air bottom screws in the bottom screw bin. They should say MBA on them. I think that is everything. So let's double check and see. Yep, that looks nice and sturdy, nice and hard, and rigid. Now let's just clean this up with alcohol. I'm going to try to avoid using acetone because the terminal is plastic, and I've seen it at melt with acetone, so we're just going to use alcohol this time to dry everything up. Now the important thing is after all this, we're going to find out if it works. You like the attention, lol. I'm not sure what that means. Okay. Okay. And I want to say that is as good as I'm going to be able to get it. Let's find out if it works. So now we need to plug our little like spacer, or the part that actually applies pressure to the battery. We got to plug it back in. Now we got to float the board. Find out if that fixed everything. So let's switch over to the temporarily angled overhead camera. And kind of clean up our area. No longer need our UV pin. We're done with our solder. And then our scratch brushes we don't need anymore. So let's go ahead and put that up. Apologize for the stream. Like, oh. Now, once again, kind of talking about how time is very important to me right now. I was planning on having this one done a little sooner so I could work on something else. Okay, so let's go ahead and reverse, putting this all together. And we don't need the fume extractor on anymore, so let's go ahead and turn that off. Now, what we need to do is put on the scroll wheel first. So the scroll wheel is held together with a jaw connector. Now, here is a little trick I like to show people, and it's the center click button. You can see it doesn't actually rest here. So what we're going to do is we're going to line it in its hole. It's kind of got like ridges on the side of it. What we're going to do is we're going to let it rest in its place, and then we're going to grab some adhesive, some tape. Painter's tape, double-sided red tape could work. Kapton tape works. That's what I'm going to use today, some Kapton tape. And that's just going to hold the button in place so it doesn't move around when we're putting our midframe back on. Now, we can take the board, and rest it back on top. If you have a 6th or a 7th generation, then you would have screws you would put in. However, this one is just the 5th gen, also known as the video. So it's just held in with some adhesive. And it looks like we also have like a little grounding part right there. We're going to make sure that that geared onto the side of the frame for grounding. These are classy iPods. I still use one myself. One that I did this repair on, actually. Yeah. I had a guy who was really big into audio engineering. He says that the iPod Classics use a different type of audio DAC. I guess the codec? What does DAC stands for? What, digital audio codec? Analog codec? I'm not sure what DAC stands for. But apparently the audio DAC on the iPods has the highest fidelity, or is much higher of a fidelity compared to iPhones. All right, so now that we have all this in place, this is just kind of loosely hanging out, but we got our tape down. Now we're going to put our midframe back on. Oop. Actually, hold on. Get our LCD. We're going to take our LCD. We're going to lay it on here. Now we're going to get our midframe. The midframe's going to kind of go in at an angle just because we got to lift up for our LCD flex cable. And I'm going to loosely let it sit on top so that I can kind of play with the quick wheel. Cool. So now the quick wheel back in its home, properly clicking like it should. And now, before I start plugging in anything else, digital to analog converter, that's kind of what I'm thinking as well. I love these classic iPods and now need to watch some dank pods. They are nice, and there definitely is a group of people that want to keep these going as long as they can. And like I said, replacing the mechanical drive to a solid state drive is a phenomenal upgrade. It gives you a lot more space depending on what size solid state you put on. And just loads a lot quicker. Also, a solid-state drive uses less power than a mechanical hard drive does, so the battery life is actually better. Another thing, too, is when you're playing the LCD, you want to make sure that nothing is in the front face. I did that beforehand, so there wasn't really a need to blow it out, but the LCD in the front face looked pretty good. Finish putting our last screw in into the midframe. Yeah, if you know what you're doing, you can do a lot to iPod Classics. You can install software called Rockbox. I personally haven't messed around with that with over 10 years, but it's like a Linux-based operating system that works on the iPod. All right, so now comes the fun part. Does this work? What we're going to do is plug our hard drive in, plug our auxiliary cable in, then plug in our battery, which our battery has this old terminal here that got ripped off the board. And we probably could have reused the terminal, but I'd rather just put a new one on. Set that to the side. And I find it easier to plug in the auxiliary cable first. The excitement is palpable. The only question is, does it work? Find out here, and if I had to guess, this one is going to be a dead battery as well. Fingers are shaking. Whole hand is shaking. There we are. Go into your home. All right, so now we got to plug in the ZIF connector into the logic board. And the logic board has a giant jaw connector that we're just going to lift up. Okay, so we have a line right here on the ZIF connector that's supposed to line up with the latch of the jaw connector. I guess it's all still a ZIF connector. I've just always called them jaw connectors. And then the spacer for the hard drive, which holds it in place so it doesn't rattle around, kind of moved, so we're going to put that back in its home. Now comes the part of plugging the battery into the replacement terminal. Pedro says no pressure. Hopefully it all works. I think we're past the pressure part at this point. Okay. So, battery is plugged in. Now we need to lock down the brown piece of plastic. Everything is put together. Ooh. Before I forget, let's kind of wedge these guys in here. This holds the hard drive in place at the bottom. I'm not going to fully close it up yet, just in case. So now, find out. Get a working iPod. Right now, it looks like it is dead. So, let's go ahead and hook up a 30-pin charger. No longer need the Kapton tape here. But let's hook up a 30-pin charger and see if it starts charging. Because before, it would turn on. But of course, it won't charge because the battery terminal was ripped off. Okay. Grab a charger here. We have a charger with an ammeter, so we can actually see what it's charging at. And we are consuming half an amp right now. We have a battery, or we have a Apple logo. So let's see if it'll actually give us some sort of reading on the battery. And it's also possible that this battery could be bad. We have a replacement battery here that we can test with if that's the case. Okay, so it looks like it may be charging at this moment. It's been a while since I've used one of these, but we can see that the let's turn this on real quick. We can see that the battery indicator flashing. Not really focusing. There we are. So I want to say the fact that it's showing that it's empty on one flash, green on the other, I think that tells me that it's charging, but it's charging at zero. So let's kind of look a little bit further. Been a minute since I've used one of these, so let's see if there's anything in here. I think this is going to tell us anything about it charging. Oop. So let's give this about a minute. See what's going on here. Let's see. And this is the boring part of the video, just waiting for it to charge. And we're taking about 0.3. What happens when we lock the screen? It says that it's charging, but the question is it really charging? And I think this one is really, really dead. Let's unplug it. Of truth, let's find out if it's gonna stay on. It is. Aha! Alright, so it is a really dead battery, or it's charging, I should say. It looks like the battery is now at, we'll just call that 55%. So it looks like the battery terminal replacement was successful. Just for the fun of it, let's turn this off real quick. Let's see, it's been a while since I've turned these, one of these off, but I'm sure. I think what you do is you press the power button and the center button. Let's see if this actually turns it off. Nope, I don't think that's the right command. I think it is the center and menu. Let's see if that forces a reboot here. Okay, that turned it off. And now it's turning on. So since I took everything apart, I want to make sure I can hook up a headphone jack and actually listen to music. But I think that was a successful repair. Successful 2-hour repair that should have only been 30 minutes. The click wheel is working because I am able to move around in the menu. And the battery looks like it did die. So maybe that battery reading, the 55 assumption, was bad. Because it did show an Apple logo, and then it grayed out, acting like it lost power. Thanks, everyone. Now we just got to find out if everything else works. And then more than likely, what I'm going to have to do is leave this one on charge. Probably going to have to leave it on charge for about 30 minutes just so that the battery can properly calibrate before we can deem this one fully repaired. I'm not going to make you guys watch the repair for 30 minutes, but the whole point was to make sure that the port or the battery terminal here could in fact be replaced. This is actually pretty common. If you ever try pulling the battery out without lifting up the brown, tiny, tiny little brown connector here on the battery terminal, then you can actually rip the terminal off. Terminal's not held down with the strongest solder. And in this case, it wasn't just the terminal that ripped off, the pads ripped off in the process. Before we go, let's find out if we are going to have any music playing. That's what I'm curious about. So shuffle songs, play some Elliot Park. Music is working. Scroll wheel is working. Now let's make sure the lock button works. So we press up here, shows a picture of a lock. Fantastic. That is a successful repair. Now we just got to wait for it to finish charging. So, Pantone, well done. Thank you everyone who's watched today. I will eventually make a video that's probably about a 10-minute synopsis about everything we watched. Sure, thank you so much for linking this into the Fix It forum. And yeah, I'll try to continue doing these streams both here at the store as well as the home office. And you guys in the next one. Thanks so much. Enjoy the rest of your day.